just gone. Good afternoon. So thank you very much, Ian, and most importantly, thank you to everyone for making the time today to come along and listen to our discussion on avoiding yield traps in investing. I'll kick right off with it. For those who attend these presentations on a regular basis, you'd be well aware that this is general information only and does not take into account your personal circumstances. And before making any investment, you should consult the PDS and speak to a financial advisor. My background, just very briefly, my role within BetaShares is co-head of distribution and head of capital markets, which is a function in our business that assists investors to access best liquidity and execution, I should say, in our exchange traded funds. So what we're going to cover off on today is a few different things. First of all, we're going to talk about what is the yield trap and how to avoid it. We're going to look at three ways to invest for income on the ASX, and we're going to look through a checklist of how to avoid yield traps. Just before we do that, I'll just very quickly, for those who aren't familiar with BetaShares, just highlight a couple of very brief points. First of all, BetaShares is an award-winning fund manager. We offer the largest suite of exchange-traded funds, or ETFs, on the ASX, which ticked over to 50 funds during last week. And we're an Australian-owned and managed business. So with that in mind, what that means is that we're only ever thinking about the interests of Australian investors in terms of the product that we put to market on the ASX. We currently have about $6 billion in assets under management, and we're consistently a top three ETF provider in the Australian market by inflows, currently number two year to date, and consistently number one issuer by value traded. So there's more dollar value traded in our ETFs than for any other provider in Australia. On to the real stuff we're here to talk about today. What is a yield trap? I'm going to just read these out because I think it's important to get the full detail here. What is a yield trap? Investors can get caught in a yield trap by relying heavily or even solely on high dividend yields to select an investment. While attractive dividends can certainly be an important component of an investment, a very high yield alone can also be a red flag that the dividend may not be sustainable, or that the company could be facing difficulty and could be subject to further share price falls. A dividend trap springs when the primary reason for the high yield is a low or falling share price. Investors buy into the share for the yield alone, only to experience further declines and potentially dividend cuts. So that is a yield trap. What are some of the signs of a yield trap? Well, there are a few. Firstly, a company that is operating at the peak of its operating cycle could be subject to cyclical decline. Maybe all of the good news is factored into that business. If a business is losing market share, that can be another sign that its dividend yield may not be sustainable into the future. If the capital allocation of a business is amiss, that could be another indication. When we talk about capital allocation being amiss, think perhaps of a fully mature business that has very few growth prospects. Generally, that's not a business you would want to own. But if there's nothing for that business to reinvest in within its own business, it's probably going to pay out a fairly high dividend yield with any excess cash. So a capital asset allocation process that focuses only on yield and not anything to do with growth of a business could be a sign that a business could be in trouble. If a business has more financial leverage than it can sustain through a business cycle, that's another reason for concern. And also keep an eye on the press. Often when companies are under pressure with their dividend, there will generally be a lot of talk about that in the press, and that could be a signal to watch out for as well. We're going to look at a real world case study here, and Telstra is the potential example that I've looked at. If we look at Telstra on 30 June 2015, the story looks pretty rosy. The stock's up 17.9% for the year. It's sitting at $6.14 and paying a 30-cent dividend annually. So that gives Telstra at that point in time a cash yield of about 4.9% or a gross yield of just shy of 7%. No reason for any real concern. But let's skip forward 12 more months to 30 June 16. Telstra's share price has fallen 9.4%. That in itself may not be a sign of trouble. Share prices fluctuate all the time, as I'm sure you're well aware. What that has done, though, is to increase the cash yield to 5.58% and the gross yield to just shy of 8%. You'll notice also that the dividend actually jumped from 30 cents per share to 31 cents per share. 12 months later again, we're now at 30 June 17. Well, Telstra's share price has fallen to $4.30. It's off another 22.7%. At that point, its PE has fallen over the last 2 years from 18.5 times down to 13.2 times. Its dividend has been maintained, but its yield has gone from 4.9 cash yield to 7.21. Its gross yield has gone from about 7 to 10.3. When a share has fallen substantially like that and its yield looks high, an investor may be sucked into thinking that the prospects for that business are strong, okay? Or that that yield is likely to sustain that share. Now, it's very easy for us now, with the benefit of hindsight, to look at what happened over the subsequent year, but we know now that that wasn't a good time to buy Telstra at the end of 30 June 17. The stock fell another almost 40% the following year, and the dividend was cut. So not only did you lose money on capital, but your total dollar value of income also fell in that share. So let's just look at that specific year as a one-year holding example and say, what would have happened if you'd bought Telstra on 30 June 2017, when the stock was already off 30% or so and yielding 10.3 gross? You know, it would be easy to fall into the trap of thinking that was an attractive time to buy that business. Well, what we know is that if you had bought on that date, you would have received a cash yield of 7.21%. That grossed up would have been 10.3% gross, but you lost 39% in terms of your capital. So your actual investment outcome looks pretty poor. Your net total return, not including franking, you were down about almost 32%. If you include the benefit of franking credits, your gross total return was down about 29%. So again, not a good time with the benefit of hindsight to make that investment. So that is an example of what a dividend or yield trap is. We'll now look at some ways to invest on the ASX to help avoid yield traps and some factors that that you should keep an eye out for. One thing I want to touch on just before we get into some of the specific investment options is just to remember that the ASX, historically was a place to buy and sell shares. But these days, it's so much more than that. There are all sorts of investment opportunities available on the ASX beyond just companies. You can invest in cash funds, such as AAA, which yield, say, 2% or thereabouts. There are floating rate bond funds, such as Coupon, yielding about 2.8%. Fixed rate bond funds, such as CRED, which yield about 4.1%. And then through to hybrids and equities, which we'll spend a little more time on just now. So we're going to look at three ways to invest for income on the ASX with a diversified portfolio. And the first I want to talk about is fixed income and hybrid securities. How many of the people in the room have invested in a hybrid security before? A fair number. It looks like about half, roughly. So a hybrid security is what its name suggests. It's a security that has some hybrid characteristics sitting sort of in between equities and bonds. So what are some of the equity-like characteristics of a hybrid security? First of all, they don't have a particular maturity date. Secondly, they rank below bonds in the capital structure of a business. So that means in the event of a wind-up of a business, hybrid securities would be wound up before the bondholders of the business would experience any losses. hybrids may be converted into equity. And what we saw in Spain earlier this year was a Spanish bank that hit trouble, and they had some hybrid securities issued. Those hybrid securities were converted into straight equity, and that equity was subsequently immediately wiped out to zero value. So investors lost all of their capital. But they have some equity benefits, equity-like benefits, such as franking credits that they pass through as well. When we look at the debt-like elements of a hybrid security, we're talking about, again, the ranking in the capital structure. So hybrids rank above equity. So an equity holder will experience a loss in the event of the wind-up of a business sooner than a hybrid security holder will. They pay a regular and defined income stream, normally linked to a floating rate benchmark such as bank bill swap rate. And they have a fixed date for optimal repayment or optional repayment and conversion to shares. When we look at where hybrids sit in terms of the yield aspects, they actually carry quite attractive gross yield characteristics relative to bonds. On the far left-hand side, we have the RBA cash rate. We then look at a high-interest cash ETF. Next is a floating rate note ETF. And then a subordinated note exposure. And then across to hybrids on the right. So when you compare the income available from hybrid securities, you'll notice that it's quite comparable to the income from the equity market, and it's actually probably higher, particularly on a gross basis when you include franking, than what you might get out of most cash and fixed income exposures. So attractive gross income relative to bonds. The other element of hybrids is that they demonstrate attractive volatility and drawdown relative to equities. So you're talking about a lower risk exposure than equity, but with income that's higher than bonds. So sitting in the middle of those two asset classes. What you'll see here is the orange line is the drawdown of Australian bank shares over time and through different market events. Obviously, the big drawdown here relates to the GFC, which most of you would probably be quite familiar with. And there, bank shares fell about 50%. Hybrid securities, by contrast, fell close to 30%. A big fall nonetheless, but substantially less than what the equities did. So you can see there, equivalent sort of, or even higher income in some instances than the broad equity market, but lower drawdown than equities in general. And that's what makes hybrid securities attractive to some investors. Another factor is that hybrids have a low correlation to other asset classes. That means that the way they move compared to other asset classes isn't particularly strongly linked. So if you look across the top there, you can see a range of numbers. The lower the number, the less likely that hybrid securities would move in line with other asset classes. So what that means is they tend to find their own path. Now, when investing in hybrid securities, they've been available to invest in directly on the ASX for quite a while. But one of the key problems that investors have faced is that, based on the feedback that we've received at least, and you would obviously consider this in the context of your own portfolio, most investors don't tend to hold any more than 3 to 5 hybrid securities. That's quite a high level of concentration for hybrid securities in that you don't have many different securities available in your portfolio. Buying a hybrid fund such as HBRD, which is an actively managed portfolio of hybrid securities, can carry a few benefits. So the first is added diversification. A fund such as this could offer exposure instantaneously in one trade to 30 to 50 hybrid securities. So that diversification, very, very strong there relative to holding hybrids directly. The other factor about hybrid securities is that historically they've been a relatively opaque and illiquid market. And so what that means is that creates a lot of opportunity for active managers to generate outperformance. And as a result, active management in the hybrid space has tended to provide better returns than just the broad hybrids market. The third thing, and I think this is incredibly important for retail investors, is that the issuance terms from hybrids, one hybrid security to another, vary greatly, and they're highly complex. There are all sorts of different scenarios under which they may or may not be converted to equity and various triggers. So they're quite complex securities for an individual investor to manage. So in our mind, putting that complexity into the hands of an active manager can help make hybrid securities a much simpler investment for a retail investor. So that can now be bought in one trade on the ASX under ticker HBRD. If we look at some of the characteristics of the HBRD fund, it targets returns after fees that are greater than the Australian Hybrids Index. So it's trying to generate some outperformance for investors. It also has an objective to generate post-fee returns that are greater than cash, the RBA cash rate plus 2.5%. Why is that important? It's important because it says that this fund does not just try to outperform by falling less when hybrids are falling, but rather it has an objective to provide an absolute return, so a positive return over the medium term, regardless of market ups and downs. It also has an objective to provide a franked yield that is generally similar to the hybrid market, so that investors don't have to give up the income from hybrids in order to take on the benefits that active management can offer in this space, such as potential for outperformance, diversification and management of the complex terms of the securities. Volatility for this sort of exposure is targeted between 3 and 4%. That's about a third to a quarter of the volatility of the equity market. So if you're looking for income, similar to equities, this could be a much lower volatility way to achieve that. Another benefit of HBRD specifically is that it has the ability to roam up and down the capital structure from hybrids up to more senior bonds in order to, above all else, protect the capital of investors. So from time to time, hybrid securities can become overvalued. And you don't want to own a security when it's overvalued because it's at a higher risk then of subsequent falls. Similarly, if, you know, I'm speculating here and not suggesting this is my view by any means, but if we were to see a severe housing downturn in Australia, that could put pressure on the Australian banks, and hybrid securities would sit only one rung above equities in terms of being at risk in the capital structure. So the ability to move up into more senior bonds and cash could help protect investors' capital in, you know, the hypothetical circumstance of a severe property downturn affecting the Australian banks. So we think that ability to roam up and down the capital structure is very important for investors' outcomes as well. I now want to think about another means of avoiding yield traps on the Aussie market and ways to invest for income. And I think one of the big points I want to leave you with here is when thinking about avoiding yield traps, a lot of it comes down to diversification. If you're putting all your eggs in the basket of one high-yielding stock or just a handful of high-yielding stocks, you're at substantial risk of falling into a yield trap and that affecting your returns if one of those stocks goes awry. By diversifying across larger stock baskets and across different asset classes, from cash and fixed income to Australian shares and international shares, you spread your risk much more broadly and therefore reduce the risk of any one investment becoming a yield trap for you. Let's look now at domestic shares. What factors may help you avoid a yield trap when investing in domestic shares? I would suggest there are three key factors you want to look out for. The first is to look for quality companies. The second is to look for dividend streams that are sustainable and growing. And the third is to diversify across a number of stocks and industry sectors. Now, you may choose to do this via a number of means, including selecting your own stocks that meet those criteria. But another very simple way to do it is to look at something such as the BetaShares Legg Mason Equity Income Fund. This is a collaboration between BetaShares and Legg Mason. And Legg Mason is one of the largest fund managers in the world. They're an active manager, and they're currently the Australian Fund Manager of the Year, with about close on $1 trillion of assets managed for clients globally. The goal of this fund is to provide income that is higher than the ASX 200 market, and income that has a sustainable and growing dividend stream from quality companies. One of the beauties of this sort of strategy is that it allows us to forecast the income we expect over the next 12 months from this sort of strategy. And currently that yield sits at about 5.4% before franking credits and about 7.2% after franking credits. And the ticker for this fund is EINC, which stands for equity income. I want to look here at two examples. On the left-hand side is the income profile of the ASX 200. And on the right-hand side is the income profile of the E-Inc fund. What you'll see when you invest in the broad market is that the vast majority of your income is coming from just seven stocks. If anything goes wrong with any of those seven stocks, there's a fairly significant chance of your income taking a hit. That concentration is a risk to your sustainable and growing income stream over time. One of the goals of an actively managed portfolio like E-Inc is to spread the income generation across a much larger range of stocks. So you're not as reliant on just the banks. You're not as reliant on, you know, Telstra, etc. You have a broader range of diversification and less reliance on any one stock. That means your income stream is more diversified and hopefully therefore more sustainable. Another factor that E-Inc considers is that a high quality portfolio tends to demonstrate lower volatility. On the left-hand side, you'll see the orange charts denote the quality rankings of the top 200 stocks in Australia. The blue lines denote the quality rankings of the stocks held within the E-Inc fund. And you can see that there's a much greater tilt towards quality on the right with the blue lines as opposed to the orange. So you're buying into higher quality businesses that hopefully generate, therefore, more sustainable and growing income streams. In terms of risk, that also has the benefit of lower drawdowns historically. So not only are you generating historically higher income from historically better quality companies, but also historically achieving lower drawdowns when the market has gone awry. Here's what Legg Mason seeks to do in terms of their active management. I've mentioned several times already, the key component here is a portfolio, a diversified portfolio focused on quality companies with growing and sustainable income streams. One of the other key benefits is that it looks for after-tax efficiency. So it keeps franking credits front of mind for those investors who can utilise those within their portfolio. Also, Legg Mason utilises forward-looking projections. So that means you're not basing your investment decisions based on the past. You're basing them based on what they see in terms of forward estimates and calculations of how those companies will perform into the future. There's some of the historical outcomes there for investors. Again, point out the yield, 5.4% cash, 7.2 gross forecast. Now, there is another way to look at sustainable and growing income streams on the ASX, and that is through the Real Income Fund. RINC is the ticker in this instance. Once again, we're able to show a forecast yield and on a cash and gross basis. And here we're looking at a yield forecast of 5.8% cash or 6% gross, including franking. What are the features of this fund? Well, it's very similar to the previous one that we looked at in that it's focused on quality businesses, sustainable and growing income streams. But the one difference here is that it focuses on companies that hold what are called real assets. Is anyone familiar with what real assets are? couple of hands, but not many. So let's run through it. If you invest in a services business, that business's assets are really its IP and its people. If all of those people were to jump shop to another business the next day, that business isn't left with any real assets. So what is a real asset business? A real asset business is a business that's asset value is backed by real things. Now, those real things might be property. It might own office buildings. It might own railroads. It might own ports. It might own utility companies. If it owns those real assets, no one can take those away from that business. So real assets are considered generally quite defensive exposures historically. Here are a couple of examples. So these sorts of assets are considered much more defensive and less linked to the business cycle. That's really important for someone who needs an ongoing and sustainable dividend stream through time. What then is the growth of these assets linked to? The answer is population growth. So these businesses tend to be not as sensitive to the business cycle, but rather sensitive to population growth over time. As the population grows, more people go to shopping centres, more people travel on toll roads, more people go to the airport, use goods and services that are transported by rail and ports, more people use electricity. One of the key factors about Australia, and I'll point you to this chart on the right, is that Australia's expected population growth is one of the highest in the developed world. There's an expectation under UN estimates that Australia's population growth, on the right there, will grow 40% from 2015 to 2050. If we are to see that population growth come to fruition, or if we do see that population growth come to fruition, real assets should be a key beneficiary of that, whilst at the same time providing defensiveness against the ups and downs of a business cycle. One of the other factors about real assets that is important is that they tend to be highly regulated. If you think about a shopping centre, normally each of the tenants in a shopping centre sign up to a lease, and that lease has regular rent increases that are normally linked to CPI or inflation. Think about an electricity grid, again, a regulated entity, and the government allows for inflation-linked increases in the prices of utilities over time. Thirdly, think about things like toll roads. Take the M2, for example, given we're in Sydney. The M2 has toll increases linked into it that provide for annual increases linked to the higher of inflation, or 4-odd% per annum. So they've got this ability to pass through price rises and inflation to their end users. That means that if we face an inflationary environment, these assets should be relatively well protected and should be able to grow their income streams through time as a result. So what's been the historical outcome of these sorts of strategies over the long run? Well, first of all, historically, you've seen dividend income of about, or dividend yield of about 7.5% relative to about 4.5% for the broad market. You've seen total return being capital growth plus dividends of about 17% per annum relative to about 8.8% for the broad market. And volatility, which is often a measure of risk for real assets, at 8.6% versus about 11.2% for the market. So we're looking here at ways to build defensive, sustainable and growing dividend streams from high quality businesses. If you achieve those factors, you're very likely to avoid dividend yield traps. Once again, this sort of exposure has a preference towards quality. In this instance, it's the grey lines that denote the R-Inc fund holdings relative to the broad market. And you can see, again, a skew towards the right-hand side, which shows higher quality businesses. And that, again, demonstrates lower drawdowns in tough market environments, with the maximum drawdown of 10.1% over that period, relative to about 15% for the broad market. So a quality tilt with lower historical drawdowns. I'll just touch again. You can see the long run performance there over various periods of time, but forecast unfranked yield of 5.8%, forecast franked yield of 6%. So focusing on quality, sustainable, growing dividend streams with a professional manager to help you avoid dividend yield traps in the market. I want to touch on a third asset class now, which is global equities. With global shares historically yielding about 2% per annum, many income-focused investors may have overlooked the opportunity in global shares because they didn't want to give up the income potential of the Australian market, which has historically yielded closer to 4.25%, 4.5%. I would question, though, whether that is a wise thing in the long run. Global shares can add a great deal of diversification to a portfolio. Another factor to consider is Australian shares make up only 2.3% of the global share market. So if you're only investing in Australian shares, you're investing in a tiny, tiny fraction of the global opportunity. Let's think about this another way in an Australian context. Please put your hand up if you think you could build a high-quality Australian share portfolio with only having access to 2.3% of the shares on the ASX. Okay, you're all facing this way, but not a single hand went up. So think about it in the same light. To me, it just seems very sensible to consider that diversification and taking advantage of the opportunities available offshore. The point now is, because of the diverse range of investments available on the ASX that can be bought as simply as a share, you can now do that. So here we've got the Global Income Leaders ETF launched recently. Ticker for this one, INCM. You can have both global diversification and access to global opportunities within your portfolio without sacrificing income relative to the Australian market. How does this sort of exposure work? Well, first of all, it looks at the global universe of developed markets, so no emerging market exposures, just purely developed markets, and it's looking for large cap and mid cap shares, ex-Australia, so no Aussie businesses, to invest in. It then runs a screening process over those shares to try and ensure for dividend sustainability. And it screens for things like dividend persistency. How regularly has the company maintained its dividend? Is the company profitable? If it is, it has a greater likelihood of being able to pay out that dividend. Is its payout ratio within reasonable measures? If it's paying out more than what it earns, it's unlikely a dividend is going to be sustainable. And it looks for volatility. Stable businesses tend to have greater persistency of dividends. And it then weights those businesses according to global benchmarks to ensure diversification and high income from a global share portfolio. Another point is, at least historically, this sort of strategy has actually outperformed the lower yielding MSCI World benchmark exposure. MSCI World being shown there in orange, INCM's index being shown in grey. And here's the yield numbers. If we look at the Aussie index in the middle, you're seeing current yield of about 4.2% cash yield. Obviously, there's franking on top of that. Look at MSCI World, which is probably the global benchmark for broadly diversified investment. Your yield there is 2.4% gross, but with any international exposure, investors in Australia get charged what's called withholdings tax. And that's where the offshore governments hold on to a little bit of that income. And it's normally in a range, depending on the country, of around 15% of the distribution. So that brings the MSCI World net income down to 2.3%. That's what you'd actually get in your pocket after paying withholdings tax. INCM, by contrast, pays a gross yield of 5.2%. But even after paying withholdings tax, you're left with 4.5% in your pocket. That is broadly in line, and in fact slightly higher, than the Australian market. So it gives you the opportunity to still have an attractive and sustainable exposure to income, but add global diversification to your portfolio, both for risk mitigation purposes and to access the opportunities that are available offshore. So, now I just want to touch on a few points for avoiding yield traps. The first one I want to touch on is, it's often considered a good idea to average in over time. If we go back to our Telstra example, if you had put all of your money in when things looked rosy for Telstra in June 2015, you would have lost close to 70%. Putting all your eggs in at one time isn't always the best way to go. If you had averaged in a little bit each year, you still would have had a relatively poor outcome, the fact is, but nonetheless, it would not have been as severe. So to avoid a yield trap, think about averaging in over time. Secondly, and I think this is probably, you know, one of my key points for today, diversification spreads risk. The more stocks you have in your portfolio, the less likelihood that any one individual stock will be a dividend trap that can severely hurt your income. Don't just diversify across individual stocks. Think about diversification across asset classes. Think about sourcing some of your income from bonds, cash, the like. Some of it from Australian shares, and perhaps some from global shares. The greater the diversification in source of income, the less likely that any one part of that portfolio will severely impact your long-run income. Don't just look at yield as a pure measure. Think about other factors, and we talked about quality businesses. We talked about sustainable and growing income streams. And you will form your own view as to whether to source that through an active manager or whether to choose your own shares. But regardless of how you proceed, think about those sorts of factors beyond just yield. Now, finally, just to wind up, there's a few compliance slides I need to go through. As always these days, market risk. Investment returns for any investment will be linked to market risk and therefore influenced by the fluctuations of the relevant market as a whole. Income payments from equities, hybrids and bonds are variable. Concentration risk. Hybrids in particular are predominantly issued by Australian banks and therefore there is some concentration in the issuers of those securities. The issuance terms of hybrid securities are very complex. We actually listed that as one reason why you might consider active management, but it's nonetheless something to be carefully aware of. Past performance is not an indication of future performance, and always consult the PDS for more information. Just to wind up now, if you are not familiar with ETFs and you would like to learn more about ETFs, then BetaShares has a wide range of educational materials available. You can sign up for our free educational email course. These slides will be sent around, I believe, later, but it's betashares.com.au/ETF-basics-course. And on there, you'll receive 6 step-by-step emails designed to give you all the facts you need to start investing in ETFs. There's also 4 exclusive e-books that you can find more information on, covering the topics there. And an ETF navigator to help you find what you're looking for in the ETF world. Finally, please feel free, and we would encourage you to sign up to our blog. Our chief economist, David Bassanese, writes regular market and economic insights, and that's available to all investors, so feel free to sign up.